Okay, a particular movie, The Last Samurai.
How's that going?
Good movie.
Good movie. I think it was a good movie. Not great movie, but good movie. You agree?
It was good.
Good.
Really good.
Or but great.
It's had better, but it was up there.
So, for Tom Cruise, an exception.
I'm good.
But you all seen Last Samurai? Like it? What is that movie about?
The Last of the Samurai.
Some crazy white guy that wants to be a samurai.
About the people that were trying to hold on to the ancient ways and the customs, and the imperials were coming in and changing everything, and they were trying to fight against it.
There was some sort of a change in Japan, and the old society was dying out, and the new society was coming in. Actually, the old army was on the way out. The new army was on the way in. And you have this advisor that came from the United States, Tom Cruise, and you know, he's teaching those people how to use rifles and artillery and all this stuff, but the way of the warrior has some charm to it. So that's what we're going to talk about today. Well, anyways, let me just, we need to start recording, right? So,
will you go back to that slide?
So today we're going to talk about the, well, they call it here the Meiji Restoration. It's a confusing term. I think the better word would be Meiji Revolution. Revolution. And what it's about, what we just mentioned, the Last Samurai. It's about modernization of Japan. So let's kind of set it up. There was a traditional society in Japan, often called the Tokugawa Shogunate. And traditional Japanese society was, well, like in Europe before the revolution, what I call feudal society, or pyramid structure, the way we use the word feudal. Layered castes, classes. So on the top there was a fellow called Shogun. Shogun was not the emperor. Actually, the emperor of Japan, imperial family of Japan, is 1,000 years old, around 1,000 years old. According to tradition, emperors of Japan are descendants of the sun goddess. Anyways, emperors of Japan were, throughout this Tokugawa period, which is the previous period, before 1868, were priestly figures, sacred figures, that just lived in their imperial palace outside of Tokyo. And just be emperor, and that's fine. But the state was run by shoguns. It's sort of like an equivalent in European history of a prime minister or a chancellor. And then you had the landed aristocracy on a lower level of the pyramid. They were called daimyo, a great landowning lords. Various regions in Japan. And these great aristocrats had people in their service which were called retainers, hired soldiers. And those were called samurai. Now, of course, this is simplification. But it gives you an idea in the same way that we did in Europe, you know. One class, second class, third class of the nobility, because the rest of the population would be Japanese peasants, farmers, who supported the whole upper echelons
shogun was like the, you say that was like the royalty or right underneath the royalty?
Yeah, it's sort of, you have that in European history too. It's somebody who does the work of the king, but without having the title.
So he'd be right underneath the emperor?
I don't know how we would call it. Number one. Number one. He does all the work, but he's not the emperor. The emperor is this, you know, sacred figure.
He's the face of...
He does, he pulls the strings. So, and Japan had from, you know, from the beginning of, you know, when we started the course and started talking about the journeys of exploration, Europeans, Westerners came into Japan, the Portuguese did, and Dutch were kind of most prominent in the first period, and they came to trade as missionaries. But very soon, Japanese figure out that, you know, these people were dangerous. The Chinese, especially during that Boxer Rebellion, called the white people the white devils. And they were right. You get these people in your country for a cup of coffee, before you know it, they're there for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And then they want to take over. Would you let them in? Anyways, the Japanese decided that we don't want these people around. So contacts with foreigners were prohibited. Missionaries were prohibited. Even though they actually had quite a lot of success, Christian missionaries. Catholic, Portuguese in particular, but anyways, no contact. There was one port that was left to trade with the white devils. Port of Nagasaki in the southern part of Japan. Famous then for the A-bomb, right? Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And Nagasaki was the only place where these and the Dutch kind of take over trade with Japan. So that was the place where the Dutch and Western merchants can come, do a little trade, and go. Well, then, to make a long story short, there was a U.S. Navy officer, Matthew Perry. In 1853, not of his own initiative, but under the orders of the U.S. government, sailed into Japan with his ships and cannons and forced Japanese to open their ports to U.S. trade. And this is what imperial powers in general wanted. Japanese in particular called it unequal treaties. And what they meant by it, trade treaties that were beneficial to the imperial power but not so beneficial to Japan. These unequal treaties are one of the main characteristics of, we're talking about the essay, transformation from the industrial society to imperialism, unequal treaties. You want to sell your goods to a country like Japan, China, a colony like India, to places in Africa, without customs duties. What are customs duties?
Levies and taxes.
On what?
On imported goods.
On imported goods. You see, if when a ship full of goods comes from China, if we put 20% tax on Chinese imports, then the stuff that we're buying in supermarkets and be 20% more expensive. In that way, countries protect their own industries against competition, foreign competition. And usually, I mean, countries are very strict in that regard. I mean, some of you have traveled abroad, overseas. So when you come back, what do you need to fill out? Yeah, what's the name of that form?
It's the customs claim form.
Customs declaration form, claims, whatever. And it asks you strange questions like, how much money do you have? Like, why do you care how much money do I have? We care. And all the countries care.
Is that in order to spend it in their country or to make sure they're not coming to like buy drugs or something like that?
They want to know what you're doing. You know, you might come with, I don't know, $5-6 million that you got who knows where, and you buy, I don't know, half of Russell. The government wants to know what's going on. You know, they're not after anything in particular. But this flow of trade could be ruinous to a country. And that's what Japanese were complaining about. Now, if we're not able to control the trade that is coming in and out of country, we have no control of our economy.
Because if you import more than you export, you lose money, right? More or less.
You lose money, yeah. You have to come up, you have to come up with a difference. How are you going to come up with a difference? You know, maybe you can come up with a difference. Some countries, I don't know, come up with a difference by tourism. Tourists come into, I don't know, Spain and spend a lot of money, so there is all this money in Spain extra. Then you can pay your imports. It's a very important stuff. Today, this is regulated by an organization that we call the World Trade Organization. WTO, World Trade Organization, which monitors custom duties of various countries and says, well, this is fair, this is not fair. And it has some mechanisms of enforcement. But in general, you know, in international affairs, enforcement comes by means of war. You know, if some country wants to push it, there is no other way to convince that country other than war. And in this case, you know, Matthew Perry, in 1853, came to Japan and started bombing Japanese ports. And said, unless you allow import of U.S. goods without custom duties, I'm not going to stop. So, this is what the Japanese and the other parts of the world called the unequal treaties. But, unlike in many other parts of the world, the Japanese drew an important lesson from this humiliation. And the lesson is basically what I told you. If you allow these white devils to roam around, you're going to be in trouble. And sooner or later, you have a situation like in China. That British merchants can go around and sell opium anywhere they want to and turn your country into a country of drug addicts, and you can't do anything about it. So, lesson from history. And a fairly small group of Japanese called modernizers or reformers were debating really what to do. And the conclusion was a rich country, strong army. In other words, Japanese strategy was unique in the world. They said, we're going to beat the white man strong industry like the Westerners have. Turned out that they did way better. Right? What car do you drive? Mazda. Really happy with it? Anybody got endorsement from Mazda? But you know what I mean? Japan is the cutting edge of technology, and it has been for the last, well, since this thing that we call Meiji Revolution or Restoration. And the second point, build a strong army, so when these white devils show up at your shores, you can send them away. Fairly simple strategy, hard to implement. And one of the greatest obstacles to this strategy is that you have these old style people who don't want to do it. And that's the plot of the movie that we were talking about last summer. In other words, to have a strong army, you have to have rifles and artillery and all that stuff, you know, that modern armies did. But according to the traditional Japanese way, it's called the Bushido, the codex of warrior. That's cowardly. To kill somebody from a distance, it's what cowards do. Kill people from the back or... Traditional Japanese code of war was samurai. We meet mano a mano, as they say, face to face. If you're a great warrior, you can meet 20 people. You've seen kung fu movies, right? One great warrior, and you know, 20 or 50, 100 around them. And then, face to face, you chop off his head. That's courage, according to the traditional warrior ethic of the Japanese military society. That's not the way we do modern warfare. We kill from distance. Now we, you know, airplane. So for a lot of, you know, people in the samurai, this was beyond them. And they resisted the change. And they were rebellious, and that's, you know, what the movie was about. But the way Japanese did this change was... That's why, you know, there are two words here. I use the word Meiji Revolution and Meiji Restoration. And it's both. In all practical terms, this was a revolution. It was a modernization of a Japanese society on an unprecedented scale. The whole medieval structure of Japanese society was tossed away. Japan was modernized. Constitution was adopted. Efficient modern form of government was adopted with government departments, Department of War, Department of Finances, surveying stuff that we talked about before, statistical offices, modern things like sewage, transportation, organized. So it was a revolution, but Japan was a traditional society, still is in many ways. It has this rich tradition that goes back, you know, not just centuries, but millennia. So in a traditional society, when you want to present something new, you wrap it in something old. You know what I mean? Yes? No? Let's try to explain. What they did was, what they said. What they did, I told you what they did. What they said that they were doing is actually they pulled the emperor out of his palace and said, these feudal people usurped, took over the powers of the emperor. And now we are restoring the emperor to his powers that the emperor had before these evil people took his powers away and made him into a figurehead. in that way, they hooked up, they linked modernization reforms to the medieval and ancient history of Japan, the traditions of Japan. And this was really a Japanese way of doing modernization. Do a modernization, but in a Japanese way. So I don't know, one of the things that I've heard, I've never been to Japan myself, but I had some friends from there, and I talked to people who went there, and one of the impressions that people have from Japan, and Japan is now in the news with the earthquake, and you can get a lot of pictures, and you can get an impression of a Japanese society. And on the one hand, it's one of the most modern societies in the world.
The children are very disciplined too. I mean, like, they learn a second and third language in school, and they have a very good work ethic.
It's a very interesting society. So what you said is the other aspect is would be, in a way, it's a very traditional society. It's kind of this combination of very modern, they have these robots that talk and bullet train that go
very
like, not like our bullet train that goes here like whooping 45 miles per hour, but train that go like 450 miles per hour, maybe 300 miles per hour. And then have these traditional values that are still around. Respect to the superiors, in the family, obedience and stuff of that sort. And part of that stuff you can see, in the images that come from the news now in the earthquake. Seen some? So it's this especially interesting Japanese combination of things. And it's one of the few countries. I would say that Russia tried the same thing as Japan, but with much less success. But this modernization of Japan, or, as they call it, Meiji Restoration, is one of the great success stories of modern times. Up until recently, Japan was the second largest economy in the world. And it's a very unlikely place to, there were a lot of problems as far as industrialization of Japan goes. Japan doesn't have natural resources that were available in Great Britain or Europe or in good chunks of Russia. Has no coal, no iron ore, no oil. It was hard. Well, but interestingly enough, this process of modernization, industrialization of Japan quickly led to imperial expansion of Japan. And for the reasons I have just told you about. Where do I find iron ore? Across the Sea of Japan, in Korea, or in the northern parts of China that were called Manchuria. It became an area of Japanese involvement since the beginning of the 20th century. Manchuria. Northern part of China and was especially important because the Chinese ruling dynasty was called Qing or Manchu. Manchu. Now, China's ruling dynasty, I mentioned that before, was sort of without power, not sort of, really without power. China was divided into these spheres of influence. Regions of China that, one part was under the influence of the British, Americans, German, Russians. People often forget, but to the north of China is Russia. And Russians had their interests in the Pacific, Manchuria, China, and it says Russian Empire, Japan over here. So Manchuria was a place close to Japan, Korea too, where Japanese industries could find natural resources that it needed. The problem was that Russian Trans-Siberian railways went through the same place. Here it is, here to the city of Vladivostok on the Pacific Ocean, and actually here the city of Port Arthur, which the Chinese were forced to lease to Russians. So conflict between Russia and Japan developed that culminated in the war of 1905. And remember, this is very typical. Your book mentions more conflicts than I was able to mention. And I skipped them because I want you to get the main idea. This is the stuff, the conflict, that led to World War I. World War I started because of imperial rivalry. Various imperial powers, and you know, what do we have so far? Britain, France, Germany, Russia, Italy, and Japan. Have their interests in a certain area. These interests collide, and if they cannot resolve it peacefully, they go to war. And they got used to it, these six imperial powers, they got used to going to happy little wars that would just end quickly and end up with a negotiated settlement. This war of 1905 between Russia and Japan is an important example, but there were war, you could call it a war, it's kind of always hard to, you know, sometimes those are labeled as incidents, I don't know, French on the one side, the Germans on the other side, they start shooting for 2 days, and then they stop, and then they negotiate. Was it a war? Or was it something else? There was an incident of this kind, for example, in Morocco, a country that we call Morocco. Check where Morocco is. It's on the west coast of Africa. Morocco. French wanted to get in. The Germans said, now you're not getting in. Come and stop me. They came, tried to stop them, and then, you know, they start shooting for a while, and okay, let's negotiate. And what do they negotiate? Well, then the Germans say, okay, you have Morocco, but we'll have something else. Germany, East Africa. Okay, good. There were war that almost started in the Sudan between the French and the British on this same period. The French want to get into Sudan, the British want to get into Sudan. They get there, they look at each other, maybe shoot a little bit. Then the French say, okay, there's more of you guys in here, you have the Sudan. But we're going to take Chad. What's Chad? You don't want to know. They really didn't care at the end too much. Anyways, it's really funny times. So you have wars of this kind all over the place. For incidents. And any of these wars could have started a world war, which means all the powers get involved. How come? It starts very simply. You know, you have one power A and power B, and they start shooting. Now, if they shoot for 2 or 3 days, then everybody's going to be quiet and do nothing. But if they start shooting for 3 years, or 2 years, or longer time, then other powers are going to take sides. And then power C is going to ally itself with power B, and power D is going to sell, ally itself with power A, and then power E, you know what I mean? This is what the book called The Shifting Alliances. So it's very hard to remember all the details and when it happened, and when the French were about to go to war with the Germans, and when they were about to shoot at the British. But if you get the main structure of the thing, then you understand each individual occurrence. And this happened in particular in this war between Russia and Japan. The French sided with the Russians. Why? I told you that the Trans-Siberian Railway, going from Vladivostok and Port Arthur all the way back west in Moscow, 9,000 something kilometers, 6,000 and something miles, roughly speaking, was by and large a French investment. If Russia goes bust, stock market goes down. Now, the French didn't intervene directly, you know, to sell their, send their troops there, but what do you need? Credits to go to war? And the British sided actually with the Japanese for their own reasons. The British were afraid of the Russian influence in China and in places like Afghanistan and Central Asia. So they thought, oh, okay, if the Japanese teach the Russians the lesson, then we'd have less trouble in Afghanistan because the Russians are going to be, you know, with a tail between their legs and will be scot-free for about 3 years. Very bad period of history, very immoral, I would put it. But anyways, but it did not explode into a world war. It did not explode into a world war. It ended up being a conflict between Russians and Japanese. They fought on the land, but most important battles actually happened on the sea, or at the sea. Russians got into this war just foolishly. Foolishly. It was to blame is the Russian Tsar and his advisors, who kind of thought that a sweet little war will enhance the position of the Tsar, who was under a lot of pressure and criticism. Russians wanted democratic reforms, and the Tsar was not willing to give them that. So he said, well, let's have a little nice patriotic war that, you know, is going to last for a couple of months, and then we have parades afterwards, and everybody's going to forget about freedom, democracy, and all those irrelevant things. So the Russian side got into a war a bit foolishly, and also with some element of racist motivations. There was a good element of racism in the Russian decision to go to war. Basically, you know, these are Asians. Russians, we are Europeans. We've been a European power for so long. White people are better than non-white people. We're going to teach those Asians a lesson before you can say this is, I want to say the word, anti-disestablishmentarianism. It's the longest word in the English language. But anyways, read it anyway. Okay, so there was a good chunk of racial motivation in it. Those Asians don't know better. I'm going to fix it quickly. And the Russians did it, one of the main problems was to beat the Japanese at the sea. So, Russians didn't have enough ships in the Pacific to meet the Japanese fleet. But Russia was a great power of the time, and they decided to send their fleet from Europe, from the Baltic, from the Black Sea, all around the world, to the Sea of Japan, to teach Japanese a lesson. And they traveled for months. It took them almost a year to get there. And you know, this stuff was reported in the papers, and everybody was excited, you know, our boys are going to go there in Japan and teach those people a lesson. And when they came over, it was over in about 2 days. Japanese fleet sunk Russian fleet. So, the main points, sum it up, before we start with World War I, after the exam. Unequal treaties, conflict between imperial powers. This stuff, Meiji Restoration, Revolution, is one of those crossroads that the book talks about. With Matthew Perry, Japanese society was at a crossroads. Are we going to take it, or are we going to do something about it? And they definitely decided to do something about it. And Japan is a success story in this regard. Remember these imperial conflicts, conflicts with imperial power, were the ones who led to World War I. And the place sort of surprised everybody. It was the Balkans. The conflict between the Germans and Russians in the Balkans, which actually the Balkans was not a